Okay, the first of three of Newton's laws. His first law of motion is a very, very important one. First of all, a painting of our friend Sir Isaac Newton, who lived in the 1600s into the early 1700s. He said, "If I have done the public any service, it is due to my patient thought." He also said, "If I've seen further than others, it is by standing on the shoulders of giants." Others had gone before him, and he built upon their work. Others would come after him and have come after him and have built on his work. And that's the process of science. But he was a great thinker and had a lot of patient thought. In fact, I recommend this to you as well. In whatever career you're going to pursue, it's really that patient thought that will take you outside of the box, that will help you understand a difficult problem, be it social, political, scientific. Patient thought is valued highly by Sir Isaac Newton. Newton's first law, and I've carefully thought about the wording of these laws. The wording isn't identical to that in the textbook or elsewhere, but 26 years of teaching have taught me that precision in language in these laws is important for students' understanding. So each word matters in this definition, in the statement of Newton's first law. An object in motion will remain in motion with a constant velocity. Let me remind ourselves what constant velocity is. Velocity is a vector. It has a magnitude, which is the speed, and it has a direction. Both of those have to be constant for the velocity to be constant. So you can be going along 55 miles an hour, and even though you're still going 55 miles an hour when you go around a turn, your velocity is not constant. Your speed is, but your velocity isn't. Why? Because the direction of the velocity is changing. So here what we're talking about in Newton's first law is a constant velocity. This means constant magnitude and constant direction. So that means you're going down a straight road, neither going up or down or side to side. You're going 55 miles an hour. That's constant velocity. Okay, so back to the law. An object in motion will remain in motion with constant velocity, and an object at rest, so that's a car parked on the side of the road, will remain at rest unless acted upon by a net force. And let me remind you what a net force is. It's not, it is the vector sum of all the forces. So what this law says is that if the net force on an object is zero, if there's no net force on the object, you add up all the forces on the object. Now, there might be gravity, there might be a friction force, there might be the force of the engine pushing the tires along, there might be air drag, et cetera, et cetera. You add up all those forces, then the object will remain in the same state, either at rest or moving with constant velocity. And there's no net force needed to keep an object moving at constant velocity. Now this is I've had an argument with my wife several times on this, and I think she believes me now, but I'm not absolutely sure. And she said, "Well, Boyd, to keep your car moving, you have to push on the accelerator. You need a force to keep it going." And I say, that is absolutely true. You need a force. You've got to have that forward motion of the car pushing forward. But the net force is zero. Why is that? The force pushing the car forward is exactly balanced by the air drag and other forces that are trying to stop it from going. Otherwise, it would accelerate. So a little demonstration of this. Newton's first law says that an object in motion will remain in motion at constant velocity, and an object at rest will remain at rest unless acted upon by a net force. So when you add up all the forces, if you get some left over in some particular direction, then you have a net force. This is an object at rest. It will remain at rest unless acted upon by a net force. There's no net force on this object. There are only two forces acting on it. Gravity, that's pulling its own weight, it's pulling it down, and the normal force of the track holding it up. This object, while it's moving along the track after I've pushed on it, also has no net force on it. How so? Well, as it moves along the track, what are the forces acting on it? Gravity pulling it down, normal force pushing it up, and if we can ignore any drag or friction forces, then the net force on it will be zero. Newton's first law, again, states that if that an object will remain at rest unless acted on by a net force, or remain in motion at constant velocity unless acted upon by a net force. So what I'm hoping you'll notice here is that that velocity certainly appears to be constant velocity. Now, a car going down a road certainly has some air drag pushing against it, but it has the force of the engine pushing on the wheels to push it forward. So as a car goes down a flat, straight road without any curves or bends, there are four forces acting on it. Gravity pulling it down, normal force pulling it up, the drag force trying to slow it down, and the force of the engine pushing it forward. But even in that case, if you hold the pedals right at 55 miles an hour and the road is flat and there are no turns or bends, then you'll continue to travel at constant velocity at 55 miles an hour as long as those four forces balance each other out. Gravity and the normal force oppose each other and cancel each other out. Friction and the forward force of the engine also balancing each other out, so that the net force on the object is zero. So there is no net force needed to keep you moving along the road. And some might say, well, how do you keep moving on the road if there's no net force moving you forward? And I reassure you that you do need to spend some gas and use your engine to keep the car moving forward. That is necessary. That exerts a force on it. But that force is exactly balanced by the friction force of the air. Were it not so, then, for example, if the force of the engine were greater, pushing it forward, than the force of friction holding it back, then the car would accelerate down the road. If, on the other hand, you let off on the accelerator and the force of the engine pushing the car forward is less than the force of friction at 55 miles an hour, whatever you're going, then you're going to slow down, because that friction force will slow down the vehicle. Okay. Let's talk about when Newton's laws are valid. Newton's laws are valid in what are known as inertial reference frames. What's an inertial reference frame? It's a frame that's not accelerating. Inertial means not accelerating. So let me give you an example. And let me also say, a non-accelerating frame of reference is a frame of reference that is at rest or moving at constant velocity. So here's an example of an inertial reference frame. This woman is standing here on terra firma and watching a train as it's accelerating to the right. So this train is starting slow, getting faster, and what she sees when she looks at a ball hanging from a string from the ceiling is that that ball is going to swing backward as the train accelerates. Now that ball won't swing backward if the train is moving at constant velocity, but if it's accelerating, it will swing backward. And you've seen that before. You have a balloon in your car or something hanging. Well, a balloon is a little bit different. But anything hanging from a ceiling, if you accelerate forward, it's going to go backwards. So that's her frame of reference is an inertial reference frame. It's not, she is not accelerating. Now, what about the point of view of a person who's standing on the train? Well, your first indication that he's in a non-inertial frame is that when that train is accelerating, he's going to feel a little bit of a pull on his body. And as he observes this phenomenon, he has to say, well, wow, from my point of view, there's some kind of fictitious force that's causing this ball to move backward, because otherwise he can't explain why that ball would have gone backward. From her point of view, the natural forces of Newton's laws immediately explain why the ball moves backward. It's because it's accelerating in this direction. This is a tension force and this is a gravitational force. We'll talk more about those later on. But the most important thing is from this slide is that Newton's laws are valid in inertial reference frames which are not accelerating. They're like the woman standing on the side of the road. All right, complete the following statement. An inertial reference frame is one in which the frame is accelerating. True or false? In fact, I encourage you, there are several of these types of clicker questions in this chapter. Last time I taught this, I didn't have the clicker questions, and the students didn't do well on the conceptual part of Newton's laws. If you discipline yourself during this video, for all the videos in chapter 4 especially, to just push the pause button, answer the question yourself, then push the resume button, then you will have, you'll make your learning more active, and I think you'll learn the concepts better in this chapter. So that's my encouragement. Stop the video, answer the question, start the video, and see if you were right, and compare with what we have to say. All right, an inertial reference frame is one in which the frame is accelerating. Well, no, that can't be true, because that's false. Because we said that an inertial reference frame is one that is not accelerating. Is an inertial reference frame one in which Newton's laws are valid? Yeah. Yeah, it is. Newton's laws are valid in inertial reference frames. Is one in which the inertia of objects within the frame is zero? Well, not necessarily. There are going to be objects that have mass and inertia, and so that's false. So the answer is B. Which of the following statements is true according to Newton's first law of motion? So that is the one where the objects at rest remain at rest, or objects in motion remain in motion at constant velocity unless acted upon by net force. All right, a net force is required to keep an object at rest. True or false? False. If it's at rest and remaining at rest, there's no net force needed to keep it at rest. A net force is required to maintain an object's constant velocity. Well, that's also false, because the net force is zero for an object moving at constant velocity. A net force is required to change an object's velocity. That's true. You've got to, if the net force is not zero, if you have some net force, then it's going to accelerate the object. Let's look at this one. Which one of the following statements concerning Newton's first law of motion is false? If no net force acts on an object, the object's velocity cannot change. Okay, we got no net force. then the object's velocity cannot change. That's true. The object's velocity is going to be zero and stay zero or non-zero at a constant value. That's true. If no net force acts on an object, then the object cannot accelerate. Sorry, I said true and then I marked false. It's an absent-minded professor thinks A, writes B, and says C, right? And so there we go. If no net force acts on an object, then the object's velocity cannot change. That's a true. Sorry about that. If no net force acts on an object, the object cannot accelerate. That's true. And all objects in motion have forces acting on them. Well, not true. What about out in deep space? All planets and stars are far away, and you have an object, and it's just moving along at a constant velocity in deep space. There's no gravity, there's no normal force, there's no nothing. So an object can remain in motion with no forces acting on them. So this one is false. You know. In fact, we'll talk more about this in second semester when we talk about special relativity, where we'll talk about the fact that there is no difference between various inertial reference frames. You can think of yourself as being stationary and everybody else moving, or you can think of everybody else being stationary and you moving. It's all relative. So we'll talk more about that. I think it's chapter 28.